Today we're going to talk about the SKR version 2. Now this is a new board by Big Tree Tech, and I have to warn you that if you have the Rev A version of this board, do not use it for stepping as it will destroy your steppers. So I'm going to talk about the basics of this board real quick. So on this board, we have five steppers like we had on the SKR version 1.4. So you have your X stepper, your Y stepper, your Z stepper, your E0 stepper, and your E1 stepper. Now, those steppers were for extruder 1 and extruder 2, the last two that I spoke about. There's also two ports for your Z stepper over here. Now this can do a range of different types of steppers if you have the Rev 2 board for the SKR version 2. So the range of steppers is the A4988 or the DRV8825, which are step dir steppers or step direction steppers. They also have the TMC2130 and TMC5160, which do SPI, which is serial peripheral interface. And then you have UART type steppers, which would be something like the TMC2208 or TMC2209. And those can do sensorless homing just like the TMC2130. You can also do closed loop steppers, which I'm not going to talk about at the moment. And then you have obviously some other features of this board. You have your EXP 1 and 2, which allow the legacy displays, as well as your TFT port, which allows you to do touchscreen displays. They also added a USB drive, as well as your normal SD drive. You also have connections over here for what's known as Wi-Fi communication. And then you have your normal serial or USB communication over here. USB means universal serial bus. Over here, we have our power supplies. So on the end here, we have our power supply for our bed communication. And if you haven't noticed, I'm marked red and then unmarked. That means voltage, and this is ground. And then you have your main power supply, which is right here. So this can do either 12 or 24 volts for communication. Then they've added three addressable PWM fans so that you can control the actual fan through pulse width modulation. And so there's addressable pins in here. Over here we have our power selector. So right now I have it set to USB power on here, and it can also be set for direct power, which is normally how you should run it. But I'll get into that later when I get into steppers, because that's where it can affect TMC type steppers. Then we have our pins over here for our SWD. And what that's used for is actually loading software. So I'm not going to talk about that because it's not a normal pin that you would use. We also have ports over here for I2C communication. And then down in here, we have ports that we're going to use for, pardon me for a second, our PS on, our heat bed thermistor, and our hot end thermistors. So that controls the heat through a piece of metal with glass that judges the resistance or time that it takes to respond to adjust your temperature. Then we have other ports in here that are used for RGB. We also have the ports for our BL touch. So you have your servo port and you have your end stop detector. And then we have our normal end stops. So we have our X minimum, our Y minimum, our Z minimum. Over here we have two runout detectors that we can use for our extruder 1 and extruder 2, which is E0 and E1. And then we have a detector in here that we can use for various other things, such as power detect. So that covers most of the geography of the board. Now I'm going to talk about how to do an update. So when you get the board initially, you're going to need a USB type converter for your SD drive. So you're going to connect it like so, and then you're going to connect this to your computer. And what I'm going to do is I'll put the links to some of these devices on my webpage so that you can find them and update them. But for now, what we're going to do is I'm going to show you how to load the firmware. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to go over to the web page and see what documentation there is. So over here on the browser, I brought up the GitHub page for BigTree Tech. To find your actual board information, you can click on repositories and then type SKR space 2. And that'll bring you to that actual reference. So they do have a sample firmware, which I don't suggest using because it was only updated 16 days ago. And the bug that they found was only a couple of days ago. So avoid that at all costs because it might misdirect you on your configuration unless you know how to decipher it. Over here we have our hardware. So they have the manual on the board in English, and I believe they also have it in Chinese. Then they have their pinout diagram, which is the most important thing that you'll need to understand. So when I was talking about the PWM fans, you have fan 0, 1, and 2. These are addressable, so there are pin numbers associated with them down here. That I'll show you how that works right now. So if I go over to VS Code, what you'll see is that I've downloaded already and extracted the most recent Marlin upload. Apparently there was an upload between my first tutorial and my second, so I'll show you what happened. So if you click on Explorer, which is this, and then you click Open Folder, we're going to go to the Downloads folder, then the Marlin folder, then the next Marlin folder, and we're going to select the folder. Now, if your environment doesn't look like mine, or you've never installed VS Code before with Platform.io as a plugin or an extension, I suggest in the upper right-hand corner that you watch my video on how to install VS Code. But for now, I'm just going to move on. So the first thing that we see right here is they show us Platform.io.ini. As you can see, it says Mega 2560. That's the default chipset from the original RAMPS configuration. That's not what we're going to be using, but I'll show you what we are using. So I'm going to go over to the Marlin folder, then the source folder, then the core folder, then boards.h. Inside boards.h are all the motherboards that are currently available in the release build. So we're going to search on SKR underscore v2. And here's what has changed since the last tutorial. They have a Rev A version and a Rev B. The only one that you can use is Rev B. The other one will not compile. And I'll show you what happens when we actually use it. So I'm just going to copy it for the moment. I'm going to minimize core and source. Then I'm going to go over configuration.h. And I'm going to search on motherboard. Over here is the RAMPS default configuration. I'm going to paste our version of the Rev A there for the moment. And then I'm going to go up here and I'm going to change the serial port from 0 to negative 1. Now this may be reversed in configuration that you've seen in the past. It's okay for the moment to use it this way. It just will just work in an opposite fashion, but it still works. So now that we have that set, we don't have to worry about the second serial port at the moment, because that's used currently for a TFT display. But I may start doing this backwards where I show it over here and then this is the other port, but I haven't decided on that at the moment. But what I want to show you right now is if we go back to source core boards.h, This is the actual current chipset that we're using, and I believe it's a faster processor than the SKR. So to search for that, what you're going to do is you're going to search over here for the chipset. But that might not be relevant right away because we're going to go over to pins. Then we're going to look for our chipset down in here. So it's STM32. So we know we're in this section. Then we're going to look for F40. So we have it going to F right here. So we're going to scroll down and we're going to look for our board and see if it's here. So there's the REV-B version. Now what it's doing is it's saying use the pins or include the pins for the BTT-SKR version 2.0. That means there's a common pin set. So what we're going to do is we're going to have to find the common version, which is right here. And basically what happens when you compile is it appends that file to your compile so it knows where to refer to things. So I'm going to scroll down and show you all the pin values. These equate to what we saw in the actual pinout diagram. So if I go back over to the pinout diagram and we look for something like HE0, and then we go back over here, we can look for our extruder and find HE0. So we're going to search HE0 and hopefully find it. Now it might not be as obvious as we think, so they may readdress these as something else. HE0 is actually a bad reference. It's not the actual pin number. So if I click over here, we're going to look for PB3. So I'll minimize that and I'll search on PB3. And apparently we're not seeing it right away. So let's scroll around here and see if we can find hot end. So I'm going to search on hot end. And we have hot ends equals 1. So what we can see in here is the temperature probe. That's not what we're looking for. We're actually looking for this, which is PB3. So that should be equal to what we see right here. So that's why pins are important in understanding the pins file. So I'm going to minimize this and I'm going to set this up to build. So this is where it gets a little complex. We have to go over to platformio.ini. And earlier I talked about the INIs. These are folders it's pointing to up here. So we're going to find our chipset by looking for the STM32F. And we'll start with this one. Now, obviously, you don't see it here. So we'll try the next one. And it's probably not going to be in here. So let's try this one. So I'm going to search on SKR. And we can see the pro right here. So we're going to scroll down a little further and see if we can find our board, which is right here. So we're going to copy that. Then we're going to minimize. We're going to go over to platformio.ini, which is down here. And we're going to paste it right here. Now, in previous tutorials, I talked about using the Marlin auto build. If you need to install that, you can always go over to extensions and you can type in Marlin auto build and it'll come up and give you the option to install or uninstall. In this case, I have it installed. So that's the same for Platform.io as well. But let me click on this for a second and we're going to go to show AMB. And inside here, it doesn't know what our board is because we have to do a clean. And there's no option for clean at the moment. So if you go down here, well, let me show you it this way. Currently, when you download your release, it has the build that went with Marlin defaulted in the folder. So we're going to clean that out with the clean button, which is the garbage can. Then we're going to go back over to the auto build and you can see that it's updated and checked for the version. Now this is where it's going to get a little bit weird. If you have the REV-A version, which you shouldn't use for stepping, this is not going to work. It's going to fail. So I'm going to click on build and as you can see, it fails. Now the good thing about this failure is if you scroll up to the top, There is a little web link right in here that talks about if you've received bad hardware. So I'm going to hold the control button and click on it, and I'm going to open the page. Now, what it says is, you know, ways to get your board replaced by Marlin for their defect. So keep this in mind. They'll tell you about the actual issue, and you should be good from there. So I'm going to close out of that for a moment. I'm going to actually fix this now. So I'm going to go back over to Marlin for configuration.h. So I'm going to minimize all this and, well, maximize it, pardon me. I'm going to click here, and I'm going to change this to RevB. So now that that's all set, we're going to go back and try auto build and see if it works now. Now, currently, it still thinks it's RevA, and there's no clean button. So we're going to use the clean button right here, and hopefully it'll detect it, which it did. So we're going to click build. Now, if it does fail this time, try doing a second build, because sometimes things build out of order. In this case, it may or may not, but it seems like it's working on it. So as you can see down here, it's not scrolling like it normally does, but each one of the builds is a separate compile. And at the very end, it will show if we're successful or if we failed. If you have a third failure after compiling a third time, find the very first error that you've encountered and correct it, because the other ones are cascade errors due to that. Also, this is a good reason why you should never use an example file unless you know what you're doing, because there are a lot of settings in it that can cause confusion. That's one of the reasons a lot of people that subscribe to my actual channel will know those issues, because I make individual videos talking about those issues. So now that we've actually built it, I'm actually going to go over here and upload it. So the trick is you go over to .pio, then you go to the actual build folder, then you're going to go to firmware.bin, you're going to right click, you're going to go to reveal in file explorer. We have our drive over here that's formatted as FAT32, which is file access table. It's a way of keeping track of where files are by address. And I won't go into too deep of an explanation because it'll take a few minutes. I'll right click on firmware.bin and I'll say send to the USB drive for E. Now what I'll do is I'll go back over to the desktop. Okay, now that we have the drive out of the computer, I'm going to insert it right here. So I'm going to talk about the actual USB connection real quick. Right now it's set to USB power, which means this will power the board. But normally, if you're in this position right here for power, it'll be direct power only for flashing. So let's connect this and see what happens. Nothing happens. So I'm going to disconnect this, and I'm going to move the jumper over, and I'm going to reconnect it. And you'll see that it's flashing over here, and you should hear a beep on the computer. Now what we're going to do is we're going to go over to Pronterface, and we're actually going to check to see if it's working. So in Pronterface, currently it says COM port 1. So that is not our COM port, so we're going to have to figure out what it is. So I'm actually going to show you how to check it. So if you go over to Device Manager, this assumes you only have one device connected other than your normal ones. You're gonna go to Ports, and you're gonna expand this out. So you can see COM port 1, that's a default for a computer normally on a desktop. Then you have the other one that's COM port 15. This is our actual device. So I'm gonna close out of here, click on the COM port, and I'm gonna add a 5 to it. Then I'm gonna connect, and as you can see, it says connecting, printer is now online. So to check to see if your build actually installed, you can always do an M503, and this will show you your settings. So if you like my tutorial, please press the like button and subscribe. And to all my patrons, thank you very much for subscribing. And for future patrons, thank you as well. And everyone, take care, have a nice day, wear a mask, and get vaccinated.